turbine in the first century AD. He made a fire engine. He made talking icons, groaning altars. He made automatic doors. He made all sorts of stuff. He made birds that sing, little metal birds that sang. He was called the Mechanikos, the machine man. He could make you anything. One of the most famous things he did was to turn water into wine. And he says, a jar can be made in such a way that when wine and water are poured into it, it shall discharge at one time pure water, and at another time, wine. So as to pour out wine for some, and mere water for those whom we wish to jest with. It was a joke. It was a jest. It was a courtier's trick. It was no miracle. It was a well-known first century trick. In fact, Hero of Alexandria liked it so much, he made 5 different versions of turning jars that turned water into wine. It was a well-known party trick for the king and prince of Judea, who was Jesus, of course. And it's so simple, we can do it now. One glass. Now, I can't do this with water and wine because the health and safety were beyond to me. So I've done it with red water for wine and green water for water, as it were. And unfortunately, I'm going to get made a special pewter mug. But unfortunately, until I get it made, I've got an old Domestos bottle, basically. It gives you, which is why you mustn't drink it, honest. It gives you the sort of idea what's going on. Okay, so a touch of wine for you. Wine is red. Marvellous. A little bit of water for you. Water is green. Bit of wine. Wine is red.
It's a miracle.
It's a miracle. Water is green. So if you'd like to hold your glasses up, I think I've got it just about right. We turn water to wine. It was a trick. How's it done? Well, this is the jar he used. This is the very same jar. This comes from the original documents of Hero of Alexandria, 1st century AD, 50 AD. This is the jar he made to turn water into wine. It has divisions in the center of the jar, yeah? And with a little, he obviously knew about water surface tension, he knew about suction and vacuums, and all you need is a little bit of a vacuum and you can change from one liquid to another. It's brilliant. So this was the story that got written into the New Testament. And in a way, it's such a tragedy, I find, that millions of people down through the years have taken this as a basis of their entire faith system. So, you know, 1,000 years from now, people will be worshipping David Blaine, you know, or David Copperfield. It's the same thing. It's a tragedy that we've just followed it and people believe it without looking at it. And yet this is such a well-known trick from the first century AD. Such a well-known trick. So, yeah. Jesus the king, the courtier, he could have his court magicians, his court magi. That's what the magi did. That's what Hero of Alexandria did. He used to entertain the people who came to the temples. That's why he made altars that groaned. That's why he made altars. What did he do? He made temple doors that opened automatically and all this sort of stuff. It just amazed the people who came to the temple. He made a chariot that flew over the altar. Supposedly on magnets and various other things. So, where did he come from? We have this king, high priest of Jerusalem, very wealthy. Where did he come from? Where was he located? Everyone needs a base. Well, he came from this place. Palmyra. His name was Jesus of Gamala. And there is a town called Gamala, and he was linked to that place. But the main city that he came from was Palmyra. You might have heard of it. I don't know. It's out in Syria. And we've got a map here, haven't we? Have we got a map? Yes, we've got a map. Okay. So, this is where it came from. Remember, they were kicked out of Persia. They came out of Persia, and they were allowed to settle in this area here, which is a desert land, and it really is desert, bordering Persia, which is over here, out of the picture, and Syria and Judea, which is down here. This is what we know as Syria today, and this is what we know as Judea. Now, they were allowed to populate with all the people that came with them this borderland, and the agreement was that if they protected the borderlands against the Persians, they could have that land tax-free. So it was a tax-free state, as long as they protected those borders. That's why they had the 600 cavalry, and half of the Persian treasury, of course. Now, the place they set up was called... let's go back. Wrong button. Okay, here's the map. The place they populated was called Aurania. Remember, this lady, the queen, was called Queen Theodosia Aurania. Yes? And the place she settled became the Kingdom of Aurania, because that was her name. Sounds reasonable. Now, if we translate that into English, it becomes the Kingdom of Heaven, of course. So her city-state was called the Kingdom of Heaven. It's just a direct translation. So when it says that you're going to inherit the Kingdom of Heaven, well, there it is. It's next door to Syria. But the place they settled was actually up here. You just see it on the top here. This is Palmyra. And the reason I think that this was the primary place they settled in was because this was an oasis town. A few mud huts. It really was Hicksville. Suddenly, in the first century AD, this became the most influential city in the whole of the Roman Empire, pretty much. How did that happen? Why did something grow? Why did something expand? Well, something expanded because she had come out of Persia with half the Persian treasury. So she could buy whatever she wanted. And this is Palmyra. This is the great temple of Bel at Palmyra. It became one of the greatest temples in the Roman Empire. A lot of it's gone now, of course, but all across the top of the pillars, the tops of the pillars were all bronze pillars. It's semi-Egyptian, you can see from the Egyptian gate, and the rest of it is sort of Greco style. So we have this blend of Greek and Egyptian styles, just as you would expect from someone who had an ancestry that went back to Egypt. What else do we have here? We have, this is one of the burial tombs. They made these burial towers, so inside here it's just full of niches for burials, and you can get about 400 burials in there. That's the inside of it. You can see the niches on the left and right side for all the burials. So you can see the fine workmanship. These are some of the ladies from Palmyra. Note the wealth. Jewelry dripping with jewelry, and very fine workmanship as well on the carving. This is an interesting one. This is a burial tomb. This is the tomb of Yahai. Anyone know who Yahai is? Yahai is John the Baptist. Yeah? His full name was Yohanan Yahai. This is the tomb of Yahai. Now, it can't actually be John the Baptist himself, because this is a bit too late. John the Baptist probably died in around AD 30. This is probably about AD 80, AD 90, AD 100, something like that. But nevertheless, we have the same family, and it could well be of the same family as John the Baptist. Here's some iconography. This is early iconography. This is Madonna and Child from Palmyra. Again, this is long before Christian iconography came to the fore. Here is an angel. And just in case you can't see that, here's a better drawing of it. There's an angel, again, from the Temple of the Three Brothers in Palmyra. Early Christian iconography. And here is a saint with his halo. It's actually from, again, Palmyra.